Hello and welcome to episode 8 of Enterprise Tech India Unplugged. And we have with us Kumaran, Chief Mentor of Tiny Magic. And today we have a very interesting topic on something which is going around the world right now, and China being the epicenter of this entire epidemic outbreak. Although I have my own reservations about what really qualifies as epidemic these days. But still, what is happening in China is really extraordinary, and this has probably never happened at that level before. Last time I remember was during the SARS epidemic, sort of. And there are a lot of scenarios in the last 20 years where this scare of an epidemic has been actually, I would say, a lot of ways misrepresented, because there's no such thing as an epidemic these days, because that whole concept of millions of people getting impacted by a disease no longer exists. It just doesn't happen anymore. What do you think, Kumar?
I think that's fairly true in the developed parts, right? And it depends on the geography, local geographies. Probably in a highly populated country like India or China, right? The chance of, if something is spreadable, right, through air or water, then that chance exists. But it's not in millions. Probably it'll be in thousands or probably
hundreds. Not even hundreds or thousands.
Yeah. So that's the maximum thing. Before that, it typically get contained because we have a lot of communication of data that is happening. But I think it's also a kind of, probably it goes to my favorite topic that, you know, technology is as equally a problem as it is a boon. Okay, it's a curse, right? Also. So in today's world, like any one incident that happens, it gets tweeted across 100,000 times. So right. That one event makes it look as though 100,000
the whole world is coming down.
100,000 events have happened, because it gets repeated in so many channels through so many different points of view that you get a feeling as though that's the only thing that's happening in the entire world. Right. And that's the other side of the same communication advantage which I was telling. Just like we know that, for example, I guess in Kerala, there was a student from Wuhan who has got admitted, right? I think 15, 20 years back, we wouldn't even know something like that had happened. That guy would have come, he would have gone, he would have been treated like fever, and then that guy would have probably recovered or died. We will not know. That right. thing would have just come right. and gone.
Right, absolutely.
Today, because each and every nook and corner have this, right? It's simple. I mean, for all you know, that guy might be having a general cold and cough.
Yeah.
Okay.
I think the point which you raised about the communication, how the data is available, how the critical information for identifying the disease is now can be shared across very quickly, right? And it is very similar to the computer viruses, right? Because that the whole name comes the virus comes from the living world. In fact, at one point of time, somebody made a claim that the computer viruses should be classified as living organisms because they behave exactly like the real viruses in the world. But I think one of the things which we what you said gets amplified today, and I'm talking about now of the time when some of these things didn't exist, like maybe 94, because I remember that time there was a big panic in India, which was of plague, right? So there was a big panic in India for plague in Surat, right? And I was right then in Bombay that time, which was they said this is plague and bubonic plague, which is like you remember in history classes we used to study that this plague used to spread in Europe and wiped out like millions of people, and the panic spread in newspapers, right? So this is pre internet boom. So that, and it turned out actually eventually that it was not really plague. So and But so you can see how the misinformation can also really impact for no reason at all.
Yeah, and there were like things like people falling and then having seizures kind of a thing. And let me call it the craziness of the human mind. Okay, so I saw a meme today. So there's this guy in a train. Okay, this guy just falls in the front of a crowded train and he starts getting seizures.
Yeah.
People get up and go away. Okay.
Instead
so he
helping.
Gets up and no, they get up and run away from him.
Yeah.
Okay. So the seats become empty. So he gets up and sits in a seat and everybody's laughing.
Right.
So this same thing has become a sadistic joke also kind of a thing. So I think it's little hard. Again, it's become a problem. We have too much of information. Again, the jury is out there. Is it helping us, harming us? I don't know. But one thing is clearly sure, as technologists, as an architects, right? There's a lot of constraints that has come up, like Apple, Facebook, Microsoft. All of them have put travel restrictions on this, right? And I think it's across all cities in China, right? Or is it just to the Wuhan or anywhere, Beijing?
So this so happens that it was the Chinese New Year period, and anyway most of the businesses were closed for 1 week, right? Starting from I believe the 24th, right? So from 24th onwards they were closed for nearly 6 days, and starting back on 30th or something like that. So they just extended this holiday till 9th of February. Right. So this is across most manufacturing organization, across banks, across all businesses. So it is literally a business shutdown for nearly 15 to 20 days, which I believe can have major impact around the world, not just China. Right. And you can see the flights are getting canceled. Right. So in fact, I had meetings in China starting Monday, but that is all canceled now, right? So now, fortunately, there is technology which can do our kind of work, which is enterprise technology, which is available today for us to still communicate and do our work. And it's just that this is actually a real test of whether really can we take such a long downtime and still continue to do our work, which is it really effective? Because of course, when you work in China and if you don't speak Mandarin, there is of course a lag. And will the same technology work for us? Will the same technology work for us when we do it remotely? And because when you're in a room with people, you can have a translator and help you do it. When you do it long distance, one to one it works, but if you are sitting in a meeting room, it becomes very difficult to really get the technology. It's still not there today. I don't believe the technology is still there today, which can replicate that feeling of sitting in a meeting room, right? Somehow we behave differently. I cannot quantify what happens differently, but if you're not in the room with those people and you cannot physically see them and you cannot physically, because sometimes the emotion doesn't really carry across the wires, right? So the visceral feel is missing. So I do not know. And despite having all these technologies which we have, we still have insistence on people meeting face to face. And I don't think that is going away anytime soon in the next 10 years. I don't know. What is your opinion?
I think that's actually a very big challenge. Like my wife works in a very large company, and a lot of their operations is based out of Bangalore. And right. She's been in Chennai for close to 15 years now. Okay.
Right.
But when they are discussing, she makes call somebody, right? They kind of ask, okay, why don't you come to building 3 conference room? We'll have a meeting. And then she responds, I'm in Chennai. Oh, you are in Chennai, is it? So that subconsciously people kind of believe that everyone is locally present. And I think that might, and this is a technology company.
Right.
I'm talking about. It's right. not like one non-tech kind of a company. I think these instances where there are constraints, right? Like it could be diseases or it could be natural calamities or it could be political scenarios, which kind of puts us under travel and interaction. It just brings us to the key point. How good are we in collaborating as right. per the modern world?
Right.
Right. And I think, honestly, as you said, we are still in either ancient times as far as collaboration goes. We still want a face-to-face. We still want physical, right? Face-to-face is at least okay. We still want physical. And I think there are certain things culturally we need to kind of change. And I've been, past 5 years, I've been trying to work with a lot of enterprises. And something as simple as switching on the video, people are not comfortable with it.
Absolutely. Absolutely. That is true. That is true.
So I guess we need to get to that culture, right? So when you get into a call, I think it should become an etiquette that when the other person switches on video, you should switch on video as well. Otherwise, right. it's something like, you know what? I don't trust the person sitting on the other side. I don't trust him to see me kind of a thing.
Right. right?
And
right.
you and the person who's switching on the video kind of feels exposed.
Absolutely. In fact, most in a conference call, most of the people, I've seen a lot of memes around that, is they just put on mute and they're doing some other stuff. But once you're on video, people see what you're actually doing and you're not paying attention to what other people are doing. And you're looking sideways or this way, that way. They notice all these things and we are tuned to pay attention to where are the eyes of the person, right? And in fact, some of the if you have an app iPhone, they have this they have a feature which will make it look, your eyes will look always there as if it is, they are focused on you, even though when you're looking sideways, right, or you're looking down, it will just make your eyes appear as if they are looking at straight at the camera. So that is the level of technology which we are trying to make people believe that we are having a face-to-face interaction.
I think, yeah, so I think it leads us to the question that we really need to up our collaboration capabilities in terms of handing over work, defining pieces, small interactions, handshake deliverables, what is needed, and clearly communicate what you are thinking. I think these things are going to be tested in this time. So I would probably say that this is an opportunity for us to increase the collaborative capabilities that we have. So it's, I would actually look at it as a boon and use that as an experiment, right? Like, for example, it can be mini deliverables. Like, end of day today, what is that you need?
Right.
Like, rather than it's something like, you know, let's all sit together and keep working on it. So instead of that, it would be like, you know, we'll meet for 1 hour, discuss what all of us will do, catch up again 3 hours later, and then we'll have another 1 hour session. So that kind of a breakout comeback is probably one interesting way to work around this. And there are things that we could actually use with bandwidth coming in, right? You can have one laptop or one machine in the system, which is always video on, audio on, so that people can continue working and they can just talk to the other person. But to that, we have to cross that first boundary, right? Like, we are in the same space.
Right.
And I think it's a good opportunity to build that capability. So we can convert this seemingly bleak thing into an opportunity to increase collaborative capabilities. So I think, in short, I would say this outbreak is a great opportunity for organizations to look at how good they are at collaborating, what is their maturity level, and move it a notch higher.
So since now you mentioned how we collaborate, I think one of the things which actually people might still, actually because they are still this persistent chat part, right? Like on WhatsApp or on WeChat or on Slack or Teams, right? This whole concept of persistent chat where people work asynchronously, right? They're now this is not an expectation that means, at least for me, I never respond to any message instantly on either on WhatsApp or any other platform. If you really, really need to speak to me, you will have to call me. I don't treat those platforms as synchronous mediums. But that you leave a message for me, I'll come back, I'll respond when I want to, right? The same thing which started with SMS and now it has come to this WhatsApp. And so I think people are used to that, but I'm not sure whether they are seeing that as an extension of collaboration. They're just seeing it an extension of their conversation, which I think is a good thing, right? They say, okay, I am in conversation with somebody over a long period of time. I don't have to be physically speaking to that person right now, right? I can leave a message and the person comes back and then you leave a message. Sometimes you work within minutes of each other. Sometimes you have hours apart, right? But still the conversation is going on. So what do you think? Is this persistent chat thing really, really helping people, or is it disrupting the workflows?
I find we still haven't reached a stage where it's actually delivering benefits, because different people look at it differently. And I see that within my team. There are some people who are very studious about it. And even I find it difficult to kind of have an SLA kind of thing by which I can respond to that. And especially if that persistent chat is a blocker, correct? Probably I'm also stuck in a place where I need a phone call if it's really urgent. And I think I also have this thing, right? If you don't get a response in IM, make a phone call. Now, that is probably a cultural issue I have to learn by myself. That no, instead of me making a phone call and making it happen, can we have some kind of a etiquette, right? Like within an hour, it'll be responded. Within 2 hours, I'll get a response. Something like that. And I have to plan my work also accordingly. I cannot, let's say I have to take a decision at 10. Then I have to send out my request at 8. Right. It's not like a phone call. I call at 9:50 and then say, you know what, please send me that report.
Right.
Doesn't work that way, right? In phone call. But then that is more old age, because we are keeping on interrupting each other. Async has its own power.
Right.
And I think in today's world, we need to be able to leverage the async power. So that means that 8 o'clock, I should be able to intimate to him. And I should have a confidence that Deepak, within a 2 hour window, he'll respond. I put it at 8. By 10, I will get whatever needs to be done. And I think kind of leads me to, I'm preempting your book recommendation, Ring. I think one of the things that comes to my mind is Predictably Irrational by Dan Ariely.
Right.
So one of the key things that he talks about is we seem to be thinking we are very logical and rational, but actually we are completely irrational, and there's a lot of hidden or unknown to us, right? Feelings, emotions, which kind of drive our behavior. Now, probably when you are physical in face to face, we are able to pick up these signals subconsciously. Now, when we move to an online world, now it's become the responsibility of both the people to increase their level of verbal or an explicit communication. That means we need to ask better questions. We need to be able to communicate what we think and feel in a better manner. It's something when I used to work in Japan, when the developer had a problem, right? And the manager will ask him, can you get it done in 2 weeks? In Japan, there's a culture of no telling no to the manager. So he would say, little difficult, okay? Mm-hmm. And if he can't absolutely deal, he says, very difficult, but I will try. That means he cannot do it.
Okay.
So the manager has to make up from the expression how much he's squirming his face, how difficult it is.
Right.
Okay. And I think we have to move away from that.
Well, I think some of these things, I don't think some of these things are solvable in that sense. Means people will be people, right? It's not like some of these things have been, means if you see in the length of time, the people have been actually having a physical conversation with each other. That has been at least last 10,000 years, human beings have been interacting with each other. And in the terms of how the last 15, 20 years, the technology has changed and we are expecting people to forget what has been sort of genetically fed into our system for the 10,000 years, I think we are being too optimistic on that. So that's my opinion.
I agree with you. So it takes a lot of conscious effort to ask certain things, which is like, for example, it's going to take quite a bit of work. But if we really have to not get affected by these disruptions, right, which is physical things that's blocking in a tech world. I mean, if I just take a step back and say, you know, why can't you deliver stuff? Oh, that's because I cannot travel to that location. In this day and age, that sounds so silly to make that statement.
Yeah.
Correct?
Yeah.
Or it's something like when somebody says, fly over to Delhi to have from Chennai for a 1 hour meeting. I mean, what is it that you're going to do differently once I'm there?
I think there is also a cultural element to it. Means because I worked for this customer in China, and we were trying to sort of negotiate terms of how, because there are a lot of consultants and it's a big project, and so we were trying to negotiate that how long we should be on site, right? And we are thinking that, okay, because we are on site, we don't have access to internet, because the customer cannot really allow us to connect our machines to the internet. And there are a lot of constraints around that, right? So half a day we will work at the customer location, half a day we will go to our office location, and then we will have a better internet connectivity and all those things. But that caused serious problems with the customer, right? It's like something we made a cultural faux pas, which is like, you cannot do that. We and it's of course a very important customer.
They felt offended, project. Is it?
They felt that we are actually not living up to the contract, right? Oh, and they were offended, okay. Right? And said, this is not what we agreed to. And then says, we want you to be till 9 to 6. We want physically to see the faces of all the people who are working on this project. And we want them to be here, right? Okay. So it really doesn't matter what you do there, but you have to be physically there. Means you do whatever you need to do to manage your network connectivity stuff. And network connectivity is really horrible. So that was a concern for us. But still, we had to live with it because it is expectation that you will be on site and say, this is not what we are paying you for, that you work from your own office. We want to see you here. Right? So that is also a
long way to go.
Long way to go because this is, and this could be organizational culture also. But I believe at deep rooted sense that this is something related to what we as human beings consider as people doing work for us. You say, If I don't see you there, you don't really exist in my imagination.
We are talking about, it's not like some small time company. We are talking about two large, mature, big businesses organizations here.
Yes.
Yeah, it's a tough part. So let's hope we have these things gives us a opportunity to learn and improve our collaboration and make things happen. Right.
So coming back to your recommendation for today, you said Predictably Irrational by Dan Ariely. Is there any specific reason why you want to recommend this book? Something which influenced you about this book?
Oh, there were many things in this book which was kind of an inspiration in the work that I do. And it basically shakes the belief that we are all rational. Right. We are very logical. We say what we mean. We do what we want to do. And we are very clear why we do what we want to do. And he kind of breaks the myth around these things. Okay. And when I look back at a lot of decisions that we do, it kind of makes sense that it is the lot of hidden, non-explicit, non-verbal signals that come out in a system, whether it is people or process, which makes us take decisions. And I think when we do a real in-person collaboration, these things become a lot easier. And now when we move to the tech world, then those signals get reduced and inefficiency starts creeping in. So when a person says on email, okay, I will do it, now I do not know whether he's doing it happily, he is sad or what. It doesn't give that, it doesn't give that sense, right? I just got a mail or an IM reply that, okay, I will do it. So I think what I was, the book is kind of, once you kind of understand the pitfalls, right, then it gives us opportunity to increase collaboration. Okay, so it could be something like, as a culture, right, we could actually say, as a culture, we could have a code, right? Okay, we'll get it done. Okay, sure, we'll do it. Consider it done, no problem. So we could have a kind of code culture across the organization, such that when I say, cool, no problem, that means I'm happy about doing it. Okay, and I kind of say, okay, I will get it done. It kind of implicitly says, you know what, I'm grudgingly accepting to do it. So we come up with, evolve with newer communication forms.
Yeah, actually, if you see how people talk to each other, and then you can actually, when you are physically listening to the person, and then somebody says yes or okay or all right, because all of them mean the same thing, right? I mean, that's what I, in fact, the reason I started looking at how many ways are there to say yes, because I was trying to understand how Chinese people say yes, because they're the same word. They're different words for saying yes. And they, in a different context, they could mean, yeah, all right, or yes, it is okay. All the same, the emotional part of it, that, and in what context do you really say those things? But one episode I remember from Dan Ariely's book is, one instance which he talks about is how restaurants actually price their menus, how people choose when you order food, how do people actually decide? The first person who orders food decides for rest of the people how they are going to order. So that actually starts that cascading process of ordering. So you get influenced by what other people decide. And same thing, I believe, is for technology. You want to see how other people have done it. And if they have something, who has done, it says, if a bank is trying to decide their core banking platform, it says, okay, let me see what other banks are doing. And that's what the opinion building starts, is the first. And if somebody wants to take a risk and say, okay, how do I really take a risk? How big a risk I want to take? Right. So thanks for the recommendation. And I hope everybody enjoys reading this book as much as I and Kumaran have done. Please give us your feedback on etiunplugged.in, on our LinkedIn page or on our Facebook page. Subscribe to the YouTube channel and Apple Podcasts. We really value your subscription. And make sure, keep encouraging us to produce this content for you. Thank you very much. See you next time. Bye. See you.